What looked to be a 3-hour show was done in just under 2. AEW's learning. I'm John Rentham with my review of AEW Dark, because a 15-match card I really expected to go long, because a lot of their big Dark cards have gone a really long time. Some matches have drug out way too much. But 6 women's matches was always going to be pleasing to me, and I really hope that they feature a few more women on Dynamite, because they need to feature more of the women that are ready on Dynamite to kind of like, you know, establish, hey, we do have a women's division. We don't just have a champion that basically just feuds here and there. We do have other women. And then use Dark to get, you know, slightly unseasoned women more time and then bring them up. I don't want it to be 50-50, but they got to feature the women on Dynamite a little bit more. Anyway, Excalibur, Taz, and Ricky Starks on commentary. And I love Starks. Met him at a couple indie shows. Really goddamn good. Tremendous heel. He's great on commentary. He's great on promos. He's great in the ring. Whenever he decides to hang up his boots, years and years from now, probably at least a decade and a half, if not 2 decades, he's going to be tremendous on commentary. He's just a natural, he's just got so much charisma. The charisma's pouring out of the young man. So we have Fuego del Sol versus Miro with Penelope, Kip, and Charles. Don't call me Chuck Taylor, the butler, Chuck the butler. And Miro squashed him. Game over, the new bendy accolade. I think Kenta's going to have something to say about the game over name, but anyway, Miro gets a victory. Feature Miro more like this and with less goofy shit, not saying he can't have fun, and people will take him a little bit more seriously. So, Lee Johnson and Aaron Solo versus Jurassic Express members Luchasaurus and Jungle Boy with Marco Stunt. Stunt should always stay out at ringside because he really has no business being in the ring, my opinion. Tarzan Boy, that theme is going to get Jungle Boy over like $1 million, especially when full crowds come back. I don't know if they're going to come back later this year or if it's going to be in 2022, but I'd love for you guys to tell me in the comments when you think full crowds should come back. When do you think they will come back? When do you think they should come back? Because that's a touchy subject. So the match was fine. Got awkward at the end. But Luchasaurus and Jungle Boy are a good team. And Lee Johnson has impressed me, and Aaron Solo is also very good. And Snare Trap taps out Aaron Solo. And not the only time we see Lee Johnson, but that's okay. I like Lee Johnson. I think him and Sean Dean could be a damn good tag team. They're two slightly underutilized guys. They've been featured a lot, but mostly just in squash matches, so I'd like to see what they could do as a team, and I think both have tremendous upsides. Terrence and Terrell Hughes versus SCU. Devon's Kids versus SCU. Man, Devon's Kids have come a long way since their dad and the Pope were feuding in Impact Wrestling, and that was cut off because one of them left the company. Was it Devon or the Pope? I actually don't fucking remember who left the company. It was a very odd feud. I think this is Daniels' last year in the ring. I really fucking do. I think that he's about to... I mean, I actually got to get the sweet shirt meeting SCU at an indie show about 2 years ago. And if you remember an episode of Being the Elite where the Bucks showed up at a show in Seattle, and you know, from like, you know, an episode about 2 years ago, I was actually at that show. And let me tell you right now, the crowd, we cheered pretty goddamn loud. Now, I'm not the biggest Bucks fan, but it was cool that they flew up there and showed up. And, man, their line just to get selfies and, you know, whatever merch the Bucks brought with them, holy fucking shit, it was long. And it's not a very big venue, but they packed 500 people in there. And I think at least 300 of those people were in that goddamn line. It was something else. But anyway, as for the match, a few close near falls. Hughes Brothers got quite a bit. And then eventually we got the best Meltzer ever because, of course, Meltzer's name has to be dropped on AEW programming. 1, 2, 3. Then Anthony Monster Ogogo joins commentary. And I like Anthony. He got a little bit weird trying to heal it up in a women's match a little bit later. But I like how he presents a sporting view of wrestling. And he does have a legitimate athletic background. So it is nice. But there's being a heel commentator and there's trying to play heel commentator. And I felt like he was trying to do that a little too much. And it took away. But there's something a little bit later on commentary that I'll have to mention. But anyway, we have M'Badu and Casey Navarro versus The Butcher and The Blade and The Bunny. The Bunny was fisting and mugging and yodeling and screaming and doing a whole lot of stuff and beating up guys while the referee was distracted. And then M'Badu gets pinned quickly. Okay, in and out, and I like it. Baron Black versus Phoenix. And man, Phoenix got a whole bunch of pyro. I like Baron Black. I've been impressed with what he's been doing. I was like, okay, you know, cool. This guy has a good look. Let's see what he does. He's mostly in tag team matches, multi-man matches. Been a few singles matches lately. Got to show up quite a bit. Phoenix gave him a lot and Baron was right there for it. And I think Baron Black could be a great addition to the AEW roster. If not right now, in the near future, I think he does have something. They're expanding their television, doing another hour of TV. And if they're going to keep Dark like this, they're going to need more talent, especially whenever they decide to tour again, and if they decide to ever do live events, whatever they decide to do, they have enough talent where they're going to have to feature a bunch of people. And Baron Black could be fine for their mid-card, maybe upper mid-card when they build him up. I see big things for the guy. But Phoenix, he's a natural athlete, very tremendous. And a nice single leg crab by Baron, but eventually Fire Thunder Driver, 1-2-3, show respect afterwards. That proves, like, Phoenix is like, hey, you put on a great performance. That was really good stuff. That was actually very nice to see. We then get Shanna versus Kylan King. I like Kylan King. Love her look. Love her style. Shanna, she's fine in the ring, I guess, but with her view, she can go to fucking hell for all I care. Tiger Suplex, 1-2-3. But I hope Kylan King is featured a lot more on Dark and Dynamite because she has a big, big upside. Statuesque, talented, beautiful as hell. She can really pull off a lot of things in the ring. She has improved. Her confidence has grown a whole lot just on AEW programming alone. Sky's the limit for her this year and for the following years. Then we get Brooke Havoc, fresh out of the Nightmare Factory, 4 months of training, I believe, versus Britt Baker with Reba. The doctor will see you, meow, and that's how I'm going to hear Britt Baker's theme till the end of time. This is where Anthony got a little bit weird on commentary, and I don't necessarily understand why. Showcase for Britt, Lockjaw for the win, Santana Ortiz, New Year, New Me, now it's our turn to eat. Berta Vixen versus Abaddon, or Vert Vixen, rather. Sorry, I tend to screw up a couple names, but yeah, I love Abaddon. Vert Vixen has impressed me with how she's been, you know, with the few matches I've seen her on AEW programming. I'd heard the name, but Abaddon, she's fucking great. Cemetery Driver, The Widow's Peak, 1-2-3. All right. Abaddon, I like Abaddon, and I would hope that Abaddon would eventually become AEW Women's Champion, or at least sometime this year, but I don't think she's going to take it off Sheeta, but she may take it off of whoever takes it off of Britt, because Abaddon could work as a heel or a babyface. She actually could. I like her style, she's young enough, where she's going to get even better, but Vert Vixen, she's also quite good. Then we get the walk-off with Pretty Peter Avalon and Lee Johnson. The judges are Aubrey Edwards. Fucking hell, Aubrey looked great. And seriously, I met Aubrey at numerous indie shows. Aubrey's awesome. She's a great spokesperson for just how, you know, you can live your dreams. You can do some great shit in the ring and you can be a great commanding referee presence. She is fucking great. She's tremendous to talk to at indie shows. And I'm always willing to root for a home state talent. And she is a great, great representation of my state. And then Brandi Rhodes and Jerry Lynn. Avalon says, Brandi, you are what we like to call a MILF. Mother, I'd like to forget about. Okay, and then he says, Aubrey, you should be competing in the Kentucky Derby. It was at that point I wanted to slap Peter Avalon in the goddamn face. So, like Aubrey. But you know what? Avalon's a heel. So, Avalon does a stumble at one point when he's doing his 10 steps forward. And then 10 steps back, and it's just... it's a pageantry thing, and Lee Johnson wins. And then Cesar Bononi shows up out of nowhere. I guess he's going to be the hired muscle of Peter Avalon and beats up Lee Johnson. Okay. Don't know why. I think Lee Johnson's going to get his first win over Avalon. I hope so. Then we get Mike Verna and Ryzen versus Santana Ortiz. Ryzen never even got tagged in and Verna got beat easily. I hope Verna's okay because it looked like he landed badly. Hopefully he's all right. But Santana Ortiz win easily. Davien, I had to write down how to spell that, so I apologize if I got it wrong. Versus Ty Conte with all Dark Order and negative one. Ty is very good, and the Ty trap or whatever it is on the ground, and she gets the tap out. Ty Conte has really improved. Davien, hopefully she gets featured a little bit more. She didn't really get to do too much here, but she looks like her nickname is not America's Sweetheart. I don't know why that made me laugh. I don't know why I like that, but it's good shit. And then we have Ray Jazz versus 10 with 5 and negative 1. Negative 1 joins commentary. It is right now that I'm going to get into something very controversial. Negative 1 is Brody Lee's son, his oldest son. I know that they're doing some great things for the kid, and that's fantastic. It really is. They're doing great things for the family. They've got the shirts up, you know, so all the proceeds go to Brody Lee's family, and, you know, the family's being taken care of because the father was taken away from his wife, and... or, you know, husband was taken away from the wife, father was taken away from the children way too soon. And I get it. And it's terrible that Brody Lee passed away. And it's great that they did some shit, and they've given the kid a contract, and they're letting him have some fun. It's exploitation at this point. I don't care what company it is. I'm not the biggest fan of this. I don't fault the kid. I don't fault the people working with them. I fault the people above. There is a fine line here, and AEW has crossed it. This is basically exploitation. Now, it's not the worst exploitation, you know, featuring a wrestler's, you know, the fallout from a wrestler's death. Not by far. This did not work for me. He joined commentary. He was just a kid, happy to be there, but this did not work for me. 10 wins, and then negative one comes down, hits Ray Jazz with a kendo stick. Okay. Then Pillman Jr. comes in with a lacrosse stick and then gets beat up. I'm sorry, but I'm not a fan of this. I'm just not. Featuring him here and there is one thing, but this doesn't work for me. And then we get Matty Rynkowski. I am watching you, Rynkowski, versus Red Velvet. And yeah, negative one's still on commentary, by the way. Matty has a great look, a really great look. Red Velvet, been impressed with her. She's got some good athletic ability. This wasn't bad in the pump kick, 1-2-3. Red Velvet getting the victory. Matty should keep being brought back. She's tall and she's got a presence. They should feature her more. Red Velvet, obviously they have big plans for her, and she is quite good. She's improved a lot in the last number of months since she's been featured on Dark and Dynamite. Danny Limelight versus Sean Maluda. Limelight wins easily with a hard kick. I like Danny Limelight. I like Sean Maluda, and I'm happy to see Danny Limelight gain a victory. Hopefully this means they're going to sign him, because he's a big prospect and somebody they really could get a lot out of. Now we get Jasmine Allure versus Eva Lys. Eva Lys is not very good, but still wins. Jasmine has potential. And then Jake St. Patrick versus Powerhouse Hobbs with Hook. Hook tosses Jake on the floor while the referee's distracted. Spinebuster, pump handle driver, 1-2-3. That's really it right there. Yeah, I'm pretty certain I'll probably get, you know, some hate for what I said about, you know, how they're using Brody Lee's kid, but I stand by it. I'm not knocking the kid. I'm not knocking the wrestlers that are involved with it, but it's just not working for me. Anyway, agree, disagree with what I said. Like, share, subscribe. Twitter handle in the description. I'm John Rethlin. I'll see you soon.